Ladies and gentlemen, will you please welcome to the stage Robert Montgomery.
Hi, guys. Hello. I don't have any notes, so I'm going to improvise and just talk you through some of my work. I'll be live on the slideshow, guys. Press right. Okay. So my talk is called Subverting Advertising and the Internet as Intimate Conversation with Strangers. I'm going to talk through my billboard work primarily because that's the sort of core of what I do, is I hijack billboards and I use them for my own texts, which are kind of somewhere between text art and poetry. And then I'm going to talk a bit about the internet because digital space and digital interface seems to be a big subject in the debate around contemporary art, and I know part of this conference in other places. So, that's great. I've got a little screen here with my talk. This is really modern. So, subverting the language of billboards, it's, for me, working with billboards was kind of a matter of necessity because I felt bombarded by billboards and I felt as though media, advertising, and brands were taking over the space of our cities in a way that was increasingly maddening and increasingly all-pervasive. This is a piece about advertising itself made on a billboard, and it says, "The spectacle of advertising creates images of false beauty, so suave and so impossible to attain that you will hurt inside and never even know where the hurt comes from. And in all the pictures now, the famous people have already begun to look lost and lonely." And it's about advertising being a system that gives us images of impossible perfection to prey on our insecurities and sell us things. So, an ad for L'Oreal face cream will show you a retouched woman who the model in the picture, can't even look like. So my contention is that even Kate Moss is made to feel insecure as a person when she sees the retouched images of her selling us Fendi handbags or whatever. And I really believe that advertising is that a system that taunts us and preys on our insecurities, and that's the basis of how it works in capitalism. So my whole engagement with billboards has that background, really. And this is me and my friend David Fryer, who's over here, probably in 2012, doing some billboards over the Conservative Party's ad campaign for the election in SE1, actually. And I used to have this Japanese lowrider truck, which I bought on eBay when I was drunk. And then I put the Met Police logo on the side, which is what's on the side, and I copied the font of the Shoreditch Courthouse and I put Shoreditch Department of Advertising Correction. And I thought with such a preposterous truck and the Met Police logo on the side, I might get pulled over by the police and questioned as to why I had their logo on a weird stoner van. And I drove it around for about 4 years doing billboards and I never got stopped. Very interesting. I was looking forward to that conversation. So I work with billboards in a way that uses them as space for a different kind of voice. And the reason for that is that the type of speech in a medium defines very much what the medium says. And the type of speech in advertising is a very materialist type of speech, and it treats us as consumers only. The type of speech in news media and politics is a very specific type of speech, and it treats us as demographic only, voters only. And both of these discourses are the dominant discourses or conversations of our time, and they both are discourses only about the material, and they treat us as only material beings. And in fact, we're much more magical things. We're all universes of consciousness. We're all our own dream world. Inside every person, there's a whole universe of dreams and imagination that these dominant types of speech do not speak to. So my thing is very simple. It's to take that frame of the billboard where you normally have that materialist language and just bring a different kind of voice, a more interior voice. And that's a step closer, let's say, to the voice of poetry, and I mean sort of traditional modernist poetry like Ted Hughes, Sylvia Plath, John Ashbery, Philip Larkin, which are the poets I grew up loving. So I thought at a certain point I could take a tradition of text art, which comes from people like Lawrence Feener and Jenny Holzer, and be the next in the line of that tradition in a sense, but bring the voice of that a bit closer to the voice of poetry. And so this is not a very political billboard, it's a very romantic billboard. It says, memories of Mediterranean flowers in the streets of New York, helicopters up there every morning above the water towers, there is not silence, only when the light is golden enough to make the buildings read as landscape, every morning now, some of the things you love will always be behind you. It's about two things. It's about the romance of the city, because I find cities very romantic places. It's also about feeling the city as a sort of magical sculpture that we live inside. And I love those moments in cities where you sort of feel the weather and you're reminded that we're still on landscape. So the part that says, only when the light is golden enough to make the buildings read as landscape, I think is very beautiful, because it reminds us that cities are our nature in a sense. You know, cities are made by human society the way bees make beehives. We make them to protect ourselves against the landscape, and we make them as places to live as in communities in peace and to create adventures. And in great cities like New York and London, you can have these adventures in the city at night and you can find magical, new, wonderful, romantic things. This is a slightly ecologically themed billboard. It's called Oscar Night Poem, and I did it in Shoreditch on the night of the Oscars. It says, the flood will lift the ghosts from the Hollywood Lawn Cemetery, and they will disappear like ether in the new dead air. All the names will be erased from the billboards and the theaters and the piers and the magazines and the monuments. You live by myths of immortality, and your myths are not safe, which is about the fragility of our whole culture and whole society if we don't pay attention to ecological crisis. There won't be anyone to remember Hollywood celebrities if we let our society go towards the Armageddon we seem determined to do by ignoring global warming. So this takes you to just a few of the billboard things, and I'll let you read a few yourselves, or I can read them out if you want. This is a triptych. It sort of goes in a three under the bridge at the junction of Old Street and Shoreditch High Street. This piece I did around the time of Occupy London, and this was a poem about Occupy. There are wooden houses on land in faraway places that don't cost much money, and strings of lights that make paths to them gently and do not turn off the stars, and 100 black flags of anarchists held up at night, 100 miles apart, 10,000 miles of flags, and a row of tents in front of the cathedral guard our future. There will be a quick sickness, the kind that kills the body before the mind knows, then it will be a slow rising. I loved, with London Occupy, the dialogue between the occupiers in Finsbury Square and St. Paul's Cathedral, and Giles Fraser, who was the Dean of St. Paul's, who resigned in support of Occupy, because he could see that the kind of social justice they were fighting for was fair and right. And so I found Occupy very beautiful as a gesture and as a movement. And I did this billboard essentially because I loved what they were doing. And people talk a lot about, does contemporary art really affect society? Can it affect change? Can it connect with the real world? Is it in an ivory tower of academia? And with this billboard, there was a direct dialogue with the people it was about, because Occupy London wrote me a letter, a very formal letter, like on letterheady paper, in an email, in a PDF, signed by the funders of Occupy, and they said, look, we saw your billboard, and we wondered, could we borrow a line from the billboard and adapt it into a banner for Occupy when we occupy the Royal Exchange? And I said, of course, and they did that, and so a line of tents, guards our future, became an Occupy slogan. So there's a direct example of a piece of contemporary art having a real dialogue with a political movement. And that was sort of a really touching thing to happen. And those things are, in a sense, as an artist, the best accolades. It's nice to be in biennales. It's nice to have shows in museums and contemporary art spaces. But when you feel as though you're in a dialogue with the real world in real time, and there's a real contribution to that dialogue, it's the best kind of reward. That's the last in that triptych, I think. These were two billboards I did for the royal wedding. And they were my sort of anti-poet laureate response to that, I think. They were in Bethnal Green, where I thought the royal family might imagine people would have little street parties with little bunting flags, like sort of happy peasants. And that was my response. Parasite hordes of courtesan scum. This is a poem for William Blake, and it's about how England is sort of abused and increasingly abused, and we saw that around Brexit, as a kind of symbol of division and racism. And I think you have to remember that England is a construct. It's a construct constructed by invading kings to sort of keep the peasants in line. And you have to remember that all nation states are constructs, and that the land we live on, we own collectively, and we should live in peace, and we should share. I work also with light pieces, and these are called recycled sunlight sculptures because they're normally powered by solar power. They run from a low voltage 12-volt LED technology. And this technology is being developed to replace street lighting, and if you replace street lights with the lights that I use, you bring down the carbon footprint of a city street lighting by 90%. So it's a kind of light, I think. This piece is installed downstairs in the back space towards the food court. So you can see that in real life downstairs. And these tend to be simpler and kind of softer statements, dealing with the question of spirituality in as modern and honest a way as I can. This is on the hills above Florence, and you can see the Duomo of Florence in the background, and that's where the Renaissance, the Christian Renaissance, was created in the 15th century, and I wanted to do a poem on that hill that would be in some way a sort of hymn to the pagan gods, to the older gods that were there before we had this monotheistic religious tradition. This is a piece in Hoxton Square that says, "The city is wilder than you think and kinder than you think. It is a valley and you are a horse in it. It is a house and you are a child in it, safe and warm here in the fire of each other." This is a piece I made for the city of Istanbul at the time of the Istanbul Biennale in, I think, 2011. And it was just at the time in Istanbul when there was a sort of emerging conservative backlash from Erdogan's government. And they were doing stuff like closing down the student bars in Galata. And Istanbul, since the 50s, had this tradition of being a modern and secular state. And the beauty of Istanbul would be sitting in the old town of Galata in the student bars, drinking beer and raki, listening to Nirvana with a bunch of like hippie students at dusk, and hearing the call to prayer from the mosques on the hill mixed with that sound of the Nirvana songs, for me, was the beauty of Istanbul. And when they started to close down the student bars, I thought, that's kind of a bit of a red flag and a warning. And so I did this piece on a truck that went around those streets that said, "Everything in the city is perfect. The voices in the street, by which I mean the mix of voices, are sacred music, and the streets belong to no one." You know, you couldn't have a magical Istanbul without the call to prayer at dusk. It's very beautiful, but you can't have a magical and modern and free Istanbul without the sound of Nirvana or without the sound of the gay pride parade. And this year they tried to shut down the gay pride parade, so it's a worrying situation in Turkey. This is a piece in Berlin, and I think I come to a deeper Berlin project in a second. I did a project in, how am I doing for time? How far in am I, guys? I'm about halfway through, no? Okay. This is Tempelhof in Berlin, where I wanted for a very long time to do a project at the site of a Cold War American airbase. And this is part of my personal story, like Louis was talking about, which is that I grew up in Prestwick in Scotland, and from my math class window, I could see this little American flag when I was a child. And I asked people what it was, and they said, well, it's the American airbase. And I thought, well, we have an American airbase in my hometown. And of course, it was the American airbase where they flew in components for the nuclear arsenal America held at Faz Lane in Scotland and still holds, I think. And I felt quite unsettled by that. And I felt as though I was living in a slightly occupied country. And so I worked for 2 years in Berlin with a curator called Manuel Wisniewski. And we tried to get permission to do almost poems about peace on the site of the old American airbase in Berlin at Tempelhof. And this had been during the war, the airport where Hitler built Luftwaffes, and in the Cold War, America's strategic base in West Berlin, where it sort of held a military force. And these structures the poems are on are the baseball fields the American Army and American Air Force built on the airbase. And we worked with the city of Berlin and a lot of different departments and finally got permission to do these. And these sort of thrilled me in terms of personal history. It felt very therapeutic to take something the American military had built and use that as a structure for poems about peace. It says, echoes of voices in the high towers, all wounds explained here, all knives bandaged, all empires arrested, all castles unbuilt, all hearts unbroken. And across the field you had the second one on the American Air Force baseball field, which again has a slightly ecological echo. This is a far poem, and I do far poems like a kind of ceremony. There might be more later. It's a piece for the Kochi Biennale in India, which is the first Biennale in India. And it's a sort of exile's song. I imagine being a 17th century peasant who would have to get on a boat to determine their own lives and sail to a foreign land and sort of learn a new identity and become a new self. Far poems are my sort of contemporary response to an old Celtic pagan tradition, and I'm Scottish, obviously, and I feel quite haunted by a sense of Celtic identity because it's a sort of lost identity. I think Scottish and Irish people have a sense of an ancient shared history that was sort of taken away from us by the English Empire, and we do have that, and it's a sort of ghost inside of your consciousness. And up until the 7th, 8th century in Scotland, we'd have these pagan fire festivals that would mark solstices from spring to summer to autumn to winter. And so I wanted to take that form and make work that would be a sort of reignition of that tradition. So this is a piece for the Edinburgh Festival in 2010, I think, 2011 maybe. And it's in the garden of the Church of Scotland, which is where John Knox brought Calvinism to Scotland, and it's close to the castle. It's hard to read in this shot, but it says, rather the rain... Oh, I can't read it. Rather the rain on the window of the castle than the castle itself. Rather the flight of the bird. Rather burned than captured. It's kind of about freedom being better than power. And this one says, to wake up and be like the weather, to be no longer the broken-hearted servants of mad kings. This is one in the gardens of the Musée du Louvre in Paris, and it's about Gustave Courbet, who was a French painter who was persecuted by the French government for encouraging the Vendôme column to be destroyed during the Paris Commune. And it was a sort of a message in support of Courbet. It says, we will still erase the war monuments, even if we only have pencils of sticks dipped in rainwater. Immediately exonerate Gustave Courbet, revenge prosecute Patrice de McMahon, and destroy the Van Dome column. And you can see the Louvre in the background. I make watercolors too, which are very intimate things, and they're kind of like the traditional part of my practice, in a sense. And I love the idea that watercolor is really it's a pretty cheesy medium invented by 19th century amateur British painters on holiday in Italy. And I wanted to sort of rehabilitate that medium a little bit. And so I do a lot of my texts in that more intimate form also. It's a light piece in an exhibition in Berlin alongside Lawrence Wiener, who's an influence on my work. On the right and on the left, Ian Hamilton Finley, who's a very important 60s British text artist who is also a big influence on my work. This is a series of billboards in LA, and I'll flick through those because I'm going to finish with 10 minutes on the internet in terms of my own work. There's 10 of these and they're kind of huge. And it's funny, I mean, this is an interesting thing. I think this happens to a lot of urban artists, but you know, I'm not gonna say how many billboards that I've shown you are illegal because my mum's here, but some of them were not strictly legal. But you know, after a while, you know, this was a surprise. I used to steal billboards from Clear Channel on a regular basis, and then I was invited by an LA curator to do 10 billboards in LA, which Clear Channel donated to the Art Center for the project, which is, has a sort of beautiful irony. It's a project in Seattle that I did last year on the site of the new Seattle Light and Power Company power station. It's like plinths with text all the way around the sort of empty lot. And a big light piece in the center. I'm gonna go into the question of digital media and the internet, because the question of the internet changing art or how it affects contemporary art or its reception is always, I think, a bit over-mystified. And I think every generation thinks of the new media it has in that generation as changing essentially what art is, but I don't think it ever changes essentially what art is. And I'm giving you a quote here from Paul Valéry in 1931, where he says, "Our fine arts were developed, their types and uses were established in very different times by men whose power of action upon things was insignificant in comparison with ours." I think every generation has that arrogance. He says, "For the last 20 years, neither matter, nor space, nor time has been what it was from time immemorial." What does that remind you of? It's the way people speak about the internet, but of course, the internet is a pretty simple digital medium. And Walter Benjamin says in an essay called "The Work of Art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction," which is 1936, that he's very worried about art because he says, when we start making postcards of art and reproductions of art, it's going to be a disaster. It's going to undermine the aura of the original. And it's an interesting idea, but he was just completely wrong about it, because if you look at what happened with postcards, the Mona Lisa was a very unfamous painting in 1911, but then it was stolen from the Louvre. And there grew up this little industry of people making postcards of the stolen painting and selling them as tourist attraction, as tourist tat. And through this process of postcarding, what was a very minor painting in the Louvre's collection became its most famous painting. And so this is a postcard made at the time. It says, "La Joconde disappeared from the Musée du Louvre on the 21st of August, 1911. This is a postcard of the Mona Lisa where the face of the Mona Lisa appears as an aura if you hold a light or heat candle or cigar behind it. Literally, the painting becoming an aura. So my contention is that reproduction doesn't undermine the aura of a work of art. It, in fact, enhances its aura and its mystical power. And the internet is like a democratic postcard company. And this is what's interesting and great about the internet. where ordinary people, peers, not museums, make the reproduction based on democratic desire. And it's very interesting, and it's beginning to change the art world, which is becoming a much less top-down, managed, and selected world. There's a kind of difference now, because it's peer groups posting works of art that sometimes bring works to the attention of Biennale curators. And I know for a fact, the first time that I was in the Biennale, the curator had seen my work first on Facebook, and that's very, very interesting. The internet also is, in my view, a sort of mystical space. I think it's our collective unconscious, in a sense. You could say the internet is the ghost world of our lives. And I'm interested in the sort of supernaturality of that, the supernatural speed by which an image or a poem can travel from London to New York, and the supernatural intimacy of the immediate message in your pocket from a lover who's 2,000 miles away. This is what's really particular about this new medium. And the internet is also a medium of unparalleled, simultaneous distance and intimacy. We haven't been able to feel as intimate with distant people before. And I think that's why it's unsettling, in a sense, psychologically for us. It's also why it's brilliant, in a sense. This last 5 minutes will just trace the traveling of my piece downstairs a little bit in its life on the internet. Great. So you see, I'm going to show you what happens if you Google search just the text of this piece. The people you love become ghosts inside of you, and like this you keep them alive without putting my name in. It brings up 4,390,000 results in 0.7 seconds. So you get a sense of the depth of reposting that the image of that piece has been subject to, and you get a sense of the democratic audience the piece has reached, which is much, much more than it could reach in the Tate. Then you get to see how the piece is used in different ways. It's used here as it's in the Independent for National Poetry Day, because it was on the poster of the South Bank Center to announce National Poetry Day at the South Bank Center. That's an institutional use. You see it used here on the Facebook page of like a kid who's died. And that's a very personal use of the piece. It's a tribute Facebook page, actually, which is a very interesting thing. And very mournful space. I mean, the idea of a Facebook page to a kid who's died is a kind of a very mournful digital space. You see it here, it's been actually copied and faked by a South Korean rap artist who has unauthorizedly just copied it and put it in his video with a really cheesy red Porsche in front of it, rapping a bunch of total shit. And getting 13 million views and not giving me a fucking penny. But, and then you see from this Pinterest sample, and this is interesting, how the artwork becomes disengaged from my name, and I really like that, because it means it has a life of its own beyond the identity of the artist, and that's very, very lovely. So in this random sample, it appears with my name once, it appears misattributed to Tracy Emin once, and appears without any artist's name three times. And then we noticed something else was starting to happen. Oh, some people fake T-shirts with it, which is, again, just completely bollocks. And then it's a sort of general tribute on this page. And then to sort of illustrate this idea of distance and intimacy via the internet, we noticed that people were starting to get tattoos of the texts. And so there's a people you love tattoo posted on someone's Tumblr page. And there's another one of the people you love become ghosts inside of you, posted on Insta, I think. And so this question is interesting because in almost every case that someone gets a tattoo of the text of my piece, they haven't seen it in a museum. They haven't seen it actually in real life. They've only seen it on social media or the internet. And this kind of making real of something that touches you in the digital world onto your skin, I think, again, is like a really great compliment and really touching to me. But it's interesting that things can become virtual and go into a sort of chaotic internet subconscious and become real again on someone's body hundreds or thousands of miles away. And this is on a, some more examples of that one piece becoming a tattoo. Some people take the font into their own hands and do every font in the tattoo parlor, which is kind of funny. They couldn't decide which font to get, basically. And then this is a very beautiful one, and I got a letter from these kids, and they wrote to me asking, their mum had died, a brother and sister, and they said, could we have permission to get a tattoo of your piece, The People You Love Become Ghosts Inside of You, in a specific form, which is, the guy said, I want my sister to read it and take the sound wave of her reading it and get the sound wave of her voice reading it on my arm, and she will get the sound wave of my voice reading it on her arm. And I thought that was just a really beautiful piece about family love. And they were making their own art with it, actually. That's their own art piece made from that sort of digital conversation. And that might be it. Examples of other tattoos of other pieces. And this one, the girl wrote quite a touching little account of why she got the tattoo, which I'll let you guys read. And I think we're about the end. Oh, we're not at the end. This is a project I did with a curator in LA, and we did a billboard in downtown LA. And it says, the sun chases and scatters blue light more than it scatters red light. That's why the sky is blue when we are cloudless, when it is big gushed, and the screens which circle you like butterflies now. All your tomorrows turned to electric waterfalls. Digital culture created a new psychic love tremor. Digital culture created a new kind of unconscious hipster capitalist. Unsuck the glamour from the yacht deck as it deserves. Re-inhabit the center. Our cities will only be saved from the heart of them outwards. And we gave this piece away with WeTransfer, so anyone could go on and download that poem for free and have it in a sort of democratic distribution system. That's it. Thank you.